The planet's puppet masters almost surely have a plan. There's clearly maybe something there beyond the realm of man. And until you've thoroughly tested every last close trusted view, I find the more you think you know, the less you really do.
That's true, Dr. Zaius.
Well.
Where would we be without THC? Cause we know they're lying to us, just don't know.
All right, folks, we cast a wide net on THC, covering everything from various entities, cryptids, and UFOs to secret societies, mind control schemes, and the playbook of the power pyramid. And among all the various threads we like to pull, it can be hard to please all of the people all of the time, but it's safe to say that every listener should have a personal interest in today's topic, because as fun as the weird world is to explore, in the end, much of it just serves to distract our feeble minds from the crushing realization that we will die. And not one of us can be fully confident at what happens at that mysterious and inevitable junction. But today's guest, Paul Davids, might have a little insight for us, because in 2008, his friend, the great luminary of early science fiction and committed lifelong atheist, Forrest J. Ackerman, did pass away, but not before promising to reach out in the afterlife if such a thing were possible. Well, in the years since, Paul has documented nearly 150 instances of synchronicity, apparitions, self-moving objects, and messages from beyond that have reached him and others close to Forrest, all of which are chronicled in his book, An Atheist in Heaven, The Ultimate Evidence for Life After Death, following his sworn affidavit that it's all true and accompanied by chapters written by Dr. Gary Schwartz, a Harvard PhD and Yale professor who has been looking at the life after death question for 15 years as director of Arizona University's Laboratory for Advances in Consciousness and Health. It's a persuasive powerhouse of paranormal contact and some solid confirmation that there's something strange in our neighborhood. Paul Davids, my man, welcome to the Higher Side.
Thank you, Greg.
Of course, man. Thanks for being here.
I was looking at your logo here on the screen where it says smoke a little smoke and it says THC. I don't know if you know that the movie Timothy Leary's Dead is among the films that I've made.
Wow. No, man, I didn't know that. But I did plan to start this off by asking you about your work, because both you and Forrest J. Ackerman have been involved in some great work that I'm sure people would know. But tell us a little bit about your career and maybe about your friendship with Forry as well.
Well, it's two different questions, my career and then the friendship with Forry. I'll say a little bit about my career. I did start my interest in filmmaking really young. You know, I'm a baby boomer. I'm in my 60s now. Mm-hmm. So when I was around 13 or so, Famous Monsters of Filmland magazine had been out for a short period of time, maybe 25 issues. And I met Forry in Washington, D.C., at the World Science Fiction Convention, and he became familiar with things I was doing related to monsters, monster movies as a child. Mm-hmm. He printed some things in Famous Monsters about that, and that provided a lot of inspiration for me having a career in this field, because I got attention as a kid for these amateur movies I was making. So I focused in writing at Princeton University. I won the three top writing awards. This was the school of F. Scott Fitzgerald and, you know, the Great Gatsby.
Yeah.
And one of my awards was the F. Scott Fitzgerald Award. And I had also continued my filmmaking in college, though Princeton did not have any film program at that time. I don't think they do now. I don't know. But at that time, no, there was just a filmmaking club. And I made an animation stand and was making cartoons in my dorm room and continuing stop-motion animation films. And so I guess it was sort of under the influence of the Yellow Submarine movie when I made my final decision that I was going to try to have a career in film. And I went from Princeton to the Center for Advanced Film Studies. That's the American Film Institute. At that time, it was in Beverly Hills. And I was very, very lucky. It was an exceptional situation. They only accepted 15 students for the first year.
Wow.
And this was a fellowship to study film. I focused in directing and writing, and I picked up producing along the way. But while at the AFI, I was able to meet many of my heroes in the film world. And gradually, I worked my way into the film business. I was asked by George Powell, the great director of The Time Machine and War of the Worlds, to write a treatment for The Hobbit. And that was something that he hoped to do. But although I did write the treatment with my wife, Hollis, we never got a deal there. It had to wait until Peter Jackson could do it, decades later. Mm-hmm. So as far as my career, the development, I think my first foothold into the business was getting hired as a script analyst at the Paul Koner Agency. This is a boutique film agency that focused mainly on European talents. And Paul Koner represented the greatest of all the European talents, whether composers, actors, singers, many directors, people like Ingmar Bergman and John Huston and William Wyler, and actors like Charles Bronson may not be as well remembered now, but in his day, between The Great Escape, movies like Hard Times and Death Wish, he was the big tough guy before the days of Arnold Schwarzenegger. So that was my entree into the business. I wrote a film called She Dances Alone, which was about the ballet great Vaslav Nijinsky and his relationship with Diaghilev and about his daughter. Then from there, after the Paul Koner Agency, I was one of the creators of a television show called Anything for Money. It was a game show. I worked for F. Lee Bailey, the famous attorney. He had a show called Lie Detector. And we got into some very interesting paranormal and UFO-related segments in that in the early 1980s.
Nice.
And then I think what was my biggest break around that time, mid-1980s, I was hired to be the production coordinator for the original Transformers show.
Boom. That's a credit.
That's a major credit. And if you go to imdb.com and look up Paul Davids, you'll see that my credit as production coordinator is on 79 episodes of The Transformers. That's how many I worked on. And I worked with the voice actors, the script writers. I wrote some of the scripts, storyboard artists, every phase of the production. And it was really exciting. Stan Lee was there at Marvel then, and Nelson Shin, the executive producer of the show. He had created the original lightsabers for the first Star Wars.
Wow.
It was a very exciting time. Mm. And then from there, I was doing independent writing. I had a UFO sighting in 1987 after the Transformers show was done that was very clear with daylight with my children.
Wow.
And it propelled me. As I researched everything I could about UFOs, I discovered the Roswell UFO case. Mm-hmm. And I was very motivated to get Roswell made as a film. Mm-hmm. And it took several years. And finally, Showtime proved the movie and paid for the movie. It was a tentpole original primetime television movie for cable for Showtime.
That UFO experience you had, did you see a ball of light or actual metal craft? What was it like?
It was an actual metal craft.
Wow.
It was what you would call a flying saucer. Typical shape, dome on top, shallow dome on the bottom, silent, hovered for a while. It descended from high in the sky, came right near where we were because we walked out on the roof to watch it. And it hovered over the road in front of our house.
Wow.
And then swooped down over the valley. It was a pivotal moment in my life because after that, all the research I did on UFOs, discovering the Roswell case, the motivation to get that movie made, fighting for 4 years to get a yes and then succeeding, that was a huge breakthrough. It became a $6 million television film.
Mm.
And I was executive producer and co-writer. So that was a substantial credit.
Yeah.
From there, I started making my own smaller budget independent films, entirely independent, but most of them were picked up for distribution after I finished them by NBC Universal for television and sometimes for DVD. So I'll tell you about the names, what they were, a few of them. I did a film called Starry Night was about, it was a fantasy about the artist Vincent van Gogh. Mm-hmm. If he could come back today and discover that he was a success after all, because he was a failure in his day as mm-hmm. far as, you know, he sold one painting, and his paintings today are worth billions.
Right.
So I created a fantasy about that, and I used Don McLean's famous song called Vincent, and Universal released it. I was on television many times, and the DVD is still available, Starry Night. I did The Artist and the Shaman about Sedona, Arizona, a shaman, a Native American shaman I met and worked with there, and I was the artist. I'm a painter. Mm-hmm. By the way, Paul David's -artist.com is the main website, and my paintings are there. You know, I've done hundreds of them now, and they're in galleries, and I've had exhibits. So The Artist and the Shaman, was the focus was on art, like it was on with Vincent van Gogh. Mm-hmm. And then came a pivotal movie called The Sci-Fi Boys. Now, this one got into Forrest J. Ackerman and his tremendous influence in the world of science fiction, and how all of the major players who became big directors in science fiction movies later on started under the influence of Fari Ackerman and his famous Monsters of Filmland magazine.
Right. Yeah, so many names there.
It started, well, the magazine started an incredible trend, and some of the names, you know, who were influenced by him, you know, you have to include Lucas and Spielberg and writer Stephen King and director Joe Dante, John Landis, Dennis Muren, who has 10 Academy Awards. He was top guy in effects at Industrial Light and Magic. Rick Baker, who has about 10 Academy Awards for special makeup effects. Fari Ackerman, when Rick was a kid, Fari called him Rick Baker Monster Maker, and he had pages about Rick Baker in Famous Monsters magazine, you know, as a teenager. So these are the kind of things that influenced, you know, so many people. And then, of course, Peter Jackson. And Peter Jackson became the host of The Sci-Fi Boys, as we dealt with the whole history of special effects in movies.
Wow.
So career-wise, there are a few more films after that. Jesus in India, a major documentary film, had a major release from NBC Universal on television, Sundance Channel. For several years, it was the main Christmas and Easter movie. And I filmed it mainly in India. But it dealt with the legend of the missing years of Christ, the 18 years not covered in the Bible from age 13 to 30. Mm-hmm. In India, they think he was in India, that he took the Silk Road and was among Hindus and Buddhists during those years, and then went back to Judea and began his ministry at age 30.
Right.
So I explored that whole theory. It's absolutely fascinating.
Hmm.
So from there, I made, I guess you'd call it a Latino film. It's about a Hispanic American family. It's called Before We Say Goodbye. And it's based on a stage play. And it deals with the Catholic miracle of the Virgin of Guadalupe that is so important to Hispanic Americans.
Right.
So there was that one. And then there was the Life After Death Project, which we're going to be talking a lot about today. And this was what happened after Fari passed away.
Mm-hmm.
I did a sequel of that too. The first one was on Sci-Fi. Life After Death Project. I think pretty much all my movies are out there available, either on DVD where they have bonus features and all that, or streaming. You know, please don't go to the pirated sites. They really abuse us, independent filmmakers. They take advantage of us and causing a big dent in our profession. But after Before We Say Goodbye and the Life After Death Project, this year completed a film about Marilyn Monroe.
Mm.
It's called Marilyn Monroe Declassified. And it's a documentary that will be out later this year. And then, of course, finished this year with Gary Schwartz, the book, An Atheist in Heaven, which we'll talk a lot about today. And An Atheist in Heaven came out in April. And that you can find at Amazon, either as an ebook or as a hardback. So that's my career in movies and television. I've done some music as a character called Professor Hack Hard Drive. Professor Hack Hard Drive has a lot of music videos. songs I wrote that are sort of satirical rap.
Right.
I've done books of poetry, some comedy poetry. The first book is called Poems to Read While Driving on Freeways and Other Ways to Die Laughing.
Man.
And then speaking of your logo, my third book of poetry was called Poems to Read When You Run Out of Weed.
Love it. Love it.
You can find those all on online. There was also Right-Brained Poems for Left-Brained People.
Interesting.
And then I've done now 5 coffee table books that are at blurb.com of my art. Hmm. All my art of many different places on this earth. It's all under the art of Paul Jeffrey Davids. You know, you've got Paris and New York and Mexico and the California coast and on and on and on.
Man, yeah, you've had an interesting life, definitely. Worked on the Transformers cartoon, even written Star Wars books that have sold millions of copies.
Oh, you know, I left those out of the, how did I forget the glove of Darth Vader and Prophets of the Dark Side. The Star Wars books happened right after Transformers.
Yeah.
I received a contract from Lucasfilm to write 6 books with my wife of continuing Star Wars adventures during a period of time that there hadn't been a new Star Wars film out for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And they were working on what was then going to be the new one, the one that had Jar Jar Binks in it, you know, that people weren't crazy about that movie. But at the time I wrote the books, people were waiting for the next Star Wars movie.
Yeah.
And yeah, so that let me tell you the titles, there was The Glove of Darth Vader, Lost City of the Jedi, Zorba the Hutt's Revenge. We created Zorba the Hutt as the father of Jabba the Hutt.
Hmm.
And then we had Mission from Mount Yoda, Queen of the Empire, and Prophets of the Dark Side.
Wow. Man.
So, Greg, you can see I rarely sleep. I never stop. I always find another project.
Yeah, you've been busy for sure. Those are some impressive bullet points on the life resume. So where does 8 years of verifiable, sustained contact with a deceased friend providing personal validation of the afterlife rank?
Well, right now it's topic number one for me.
Yeah, I would think so.
It's the most important. And you know, this is the only subject that I've done 3 projects on. The documentary films came first, and that was the Life After Death Project, and then the Life After Death Project 2, Personal Encounters. That was in 2013, and Sci-Fi showed the first one.
Mm-hmm.
And then 3 more years of writing, and along comes An Atheist in Heaven, which is what I hope everyone who hears this will be motivated to explore this.
Hmm.
So we've made it available both as an ebook, you know, pretty inexpensively. And then the hardback is beautiful with the dust jacket. And it's a big work. Don't be scared by the fact that it's 500 pages, those who are listening, because a lot of it is photos. I call them evidentiary photos because they relate to this complex story of why I'm so convinced that Fari is still here, though he died in 2008.
Mm-hmm.
He's still here. Now, I never, ever, Greg, would have said something like that when I was younger, you know, in my 30s, 40s, skeptic, you know,
right,
not religious, you know, my attitude would have been, who knows? How can we know about that? Why do people believe in some of these things so intensely? Heaven, who knows? If you want to take the Bible literally, then fine. That's that's your reality. But a lot of people don't, and they just don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Hell, you know, very hard to believe in that divine creator would do something like that. So, no, that never meant anything to me.
Mm-hmm.
And you do think about these things more as you get older and, you know, you lose your parents and you start losing friends and your generation starts thinning down.
Of course.
But the first time it became a topic of interest for me about, do we survive as a spirit after the body is gone? Can there be contact between the deceased and the living? That was the big question. And the first time it became a real question for me was when I was working on Lie Detector. Mm-hmm. As a segment coordinator for Effley Bailey, that TV show. We would choose all sorts of different cases. Great variety of cases. I mean, sometimes we deal with people who are claiming they didn't commit a crime. And sometimes the lie detector would say, you're right, you are innocent, you shouldn't have been charged with that. And sometimes it would amplify guilt, and we would expose liars. So I heard about Dorothy Allison, a psychic detective who lived in New Jersey. She's deceased now. At that time, she was, well, that was around 1983, you know, so I say maybe middle-aged. And she had had one extraordinary case that I had read about. There was a very distraught father and mother whose teenage daughter had disappeared one day. And after a certain period of time, foul play was assumed. You know, the police thought she was dead, but they had no clues. And the body hadn't been found. And so the parents, out of desperation, heard about Dorothy Allison, and they had her come over. And Dorothy Allison wanted to touch some articles of the daughter's clothing. And very, very quickly after she touched the clothing, she started spouting out a whole stream of clues. And they were really strange, but bizarre and interesting. She said she's seeing a place that had two church steeples, that you could see two church steeples from there. You could see two smokestacks. There were two bridges within range of there, one bridge that was only used for pedestrians walking. She said she smelled the smell of oil, and she saw the letters M-A-R, but she didn't know what they meant. She didn't know whether those were the initials of the murderer or what it was. Well, the parents, the father in particular, I think he spent more than a year going all around Long Island where they lived, looking for some place that might fit this description. And he finally found one that matched it in every respect. And even the letters M-A-R, it was large graffiti in red spray paint on a boulder or a rock. So here's Dorothy Allison. She's pulled all of these clues out of the atmosphere, let's say, after she's touched the victim's clothing. And they did find the girl's body there. Not at first. At first, they were near it and they missed it. It was in an oil drum down in a ravine with other oil drums.
Damn.
So it was even, a year after he found the spot before the body was actually found and it was all confirmed. But Dorothy had letters of commendation from many police departments. And so I had to say to myself, this has got to be real. You know, I know the skeptics don't like it and the scientists have a hard time believing it. But this is evidence when she, you know, she wasn't involved in the crime herself. You know, that was not a possibility. And she helped solve so many crimes according to these letters of commendation. So,
yeah, that's very compelling for sure.
You know, so by 1983, I'm saying it does appear that there is another realm, a spirit realm, let's call it, that can communicate and can bring information that can communicate with us. So that was 1983, but I didn't have a direct experience until so many years later. It was 2009. So that's 26 years later, a quarter of a century later, it starts happening for me and it becomes real because of Forrest J. Ackerman.
Yeah. And this stuff is so fascinating. This Forrest Ackerman situation, let's dive into this and maybe we can get a better sense of Forrest's personality. He seemed like a pretty fun and impressive guy. Some of this does play into the afterlife contact, but he mentioned to you he'd try to get in contact if it was possible from the other side, even though he was a committed atheist, probably a little tongue-in-cheek in saying that. But tell us how this all started.
Well, as you've pointed out, Fari was an atheist, and he never prayed, didn't believe in God, didn't believe in the paranormal, didn't believe in ghosts or flying saucers. I mean, he wrote about ghosts and flying saucers and the undead and zombies, you know, in Famous Monsters magazine, taking pictures from movies, but it was always literature or, you know, stories or just fun for him.
Yeah, entertainment.
It was entertaining. He enjoyed it. And most of the pictures that he published of these things, he would have a funny caption, a quip. He would use a pun or a word play, a twist on words. Sometimes he'd find a word within a word to make a certain point. he loved those word games, mm-hmm. which becomes very important in the evidence of this case, you know, later on. So his influence, before we talk about specifically what happened, I just want to drive home the point. He was born in 1916. He grew up with the silent movies. He fell in love with the early science fiction movies like Metropolis, a silent movie,
yeah.
or the first King Kong in 1933. And he became a massive collector of all the props and memorabilia he could possibly find related to his favorite films, the science fiction, horror, and fantasy. Hmm. He collected thousands of books. He had probably thousands of movie posters, lobby cards, photos from the movies, props from the movies, the monster props themselves, masks, life masks that were made, everything that you can imagine from the genre. Mm-hmm. He eventually filled an 18-room house with all of these things. He called it the Acker Mansion. A writer, Ray Bradbury, called it the Fort Knox of science fiction. Very appropriate. and he was very generous in terms of letting people come over, having open houses so people could see this on Saturdays. And he endeared himself to many people through his generosity in sharing these things. He was also a science fiction agent, a writer, you know, a writer's agent, and sold the books that numerous science fiction movies were based on. Mm-hmm. So, as I said, my connection with him began when I was a teenager. I read the magazine. I met him. He looked at my little amateur monster movies. He gave me publicity in the magazine. He and his publisher, James Warren, both decided to do that. And it, you know, it furthered things along for me. And then I won a movie contest in their magazine. It was an honorable mention. So when I came to Los Angeles and was at the American Film Institute, I solidified my relationship with Fari. I visited his house many times. I brought him in as a, you know, to have a seminar at the American Film Institute, mm-hmm. along with the great producer, George Powell, who I met around that time. And then through the years, I always kept in touch with Fari. I went to all his birthday parties. He came to a couple of mine. He wrote a foreword for my first book. He called it a Fari word, by the way.
Of course.
Yeah, he's always with the puns, and we called him Fari. So it was a long relationship that spanned the decades. Mm-hmm. And I did become familiar with his atheism. You know, I was not an atheist. My attitude has always been that there is intelligence behind all of this creation. It didn't happen by accident. I never believed that. I think the evolution, yes, but it had help. Mm-hmm. You know, I see grand design and intelligence in everything that's here.
Agreed.
So I sort of challenged him on his attitude in the atheism, and I said, you know, Fari, what if you're wrong? You're in your 90s now. And he said, well, you know, I sincerely doubt that I'm wrong. My atheism is a well-known fact. I'll be an atheist till the day I die. He said, when the brain goes, you know, it's like a light bulb going out, you know, there's nothing more.
Right, right.
And he said, you know, but, you know, if it did turn out that I was wrong and I died and woke up to some great science fiction convention in the sky, he said, after I had my reunions with all my favorite deceased actors and my dear wife, Wendane, maybe I would drop you a line. And he said it a little bit tongue in cheek, but then he became very serious. He said, you know, but don't count on it. You know, not going to happen. Mm-hmm. So that was the setup for it. And he didn't want a funeral. He didn't want a memorial. He had a caretaker, assistant, best pal who lived with him about the last 10 years, a fellow named Joe Moe. Joe Moe said, well, okay, no memorial, no funeral, but what about a tribute? What do you think of us having a tribute for you? Mm-hmm. And he said, that would be okay. So the tribute followed his death by a couple of months. It was at the Egyptian Theater, a great restored theater in Hollywood.
Yeah.
Beautiful, beautiful place. And they filled every seat that day in early March of 2009. And that was the weekend that the weird stuff started to happen, Greg. And it's been happening ever since. I didn't ask for it. I mean, I didn't seek it. I never knew when something would happen. But yes, he did drop me a line, literally a line. As an editor, he changed a line of text in a document I had. I say he did it now after years of study and years of science and work with chemists on the actual ink in question. And this wasn't a question. This wasn't something I jumped to lightly. It wasn't a conclusion I jumped to right away. Oh, Fari's trying to get in touch with me. Things happened and it gradually became clear. You start to say, wait a minute, what's going on here? There's just too many things related to him that are happening either in a really weird coincidental way or in a physically impossible way, because something related to him has moved on its own in a room that nobody was in. Or something I had that related to a film disappeared from a house, and the whole house is searched. It can't be found anywhere. And then it's found one morning right next to a computer, right in plain sight, and there's no one physically who could have put it there.
Mm-hmm.
And then computers become involved. So many things have happened with the computers. For example, I do have a lot of – I have folders that have Fari material in my hard drives of various computers. Fine. But if I haven't opened a folder, there's no explanation for why when I wake up in the morning and I come down and I jiggle the mouse and the computer becomes awake, why would there be a large photo filling the screen of Fari Ackerman with director Joe Dante? You know, and sometimes these things would happen on his birthday or the anniversary of the year that he died. And other times they would happen in response to my having a particular focus on him for some reason.
Mm-hmm.
So the long and short of it is when these things started to happen, I took out the video camera. I began documenting everything that I could.
Mm-hmm.
And when I went to scientists to begin to study the evidence at various universities, I brought my camera to their labs, and as they showed confusion, as they showed they could not solve this easily, and eventually they couldn't solve it at all, and when ghostly things started happening to the very scientists who were researching this that they found, you know, disturbing and, you know, defying the laws of physics, and it's happening to them.
Mm-hmm.
I said, well, I got to make a movie. I've got enough material here. Let's make a documentary. So that became the Life After Death project.
Right on.
And then I had so much material. I had a sequel, The Life After Death Project, too. That was 2013 when that came out.
Nice. So let's dive into a little of this. Let's talk about that literal line that he dropped you. I believe you call it the ink blot obliteration. I think that's probably the most compelling piece of evidence in this. I think it was one of the first thing that happened, right?
Yeah. For me, it was the first thing that happened. I also think it is perhaps the most compelling because scientists have really been able to put their hands on the evidence and
right.
get involved in it and took it seriously. And you can easily interpret how it related to Fari at that time that it happened. But there have been many other things, physical things that have happened, sometimes in front of witnesses, that are very, very compelling too. It's just that you can't take those things into a laboratory.
Like exactly.
The ink obliteration. So if you get the book that resulted from all of this, as we've said, is An Atheist in Heaven. Came out in April this year, 2016. And if you get the book, you'll see all the pictures relating to not only this first incident we call the inkblot obliteration, but the laboratory work on it. There's a chapter by a chemist who spent 3 years studying it and determined it was a mystery to science. And you have his tables and charts and graphs and many pictures of the ink obliteration. It leached through to the second page of the document, and you see that. So it's all to be found in An Atheist in Heaven in a way that if there are chemistry professors listening or scientists, in a way that will speak to their language, particularly through the chapter of Dr. John Allison, a chemist from College of New Jersey. Now, you want to know, like me to tell what it was and how it came about.
Sure, please.
It was March 17th or 18th. I think it was the evening of the March 18th in 2009. And after Fari's tribute in Los Angeles, I had flown to Albuquerque and gone up to a vacation house we have in Santa Fe, New Mexico. My wife was not able to accompany me on that trip. And I often do take trips there alone, and I paint. It's where I create a lot of paintings. And I've even used the house as a production office for two of the films. Mm-hmm. But so I took this trip alone. And that's getting to be around tax season in early mid-March. So I printed out, I gave the print command to print out a document. It was 24 pages. It was a log, sort of like a diary with little shorthand notes of my business meetings of the previous years and any important business phone calls. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to print this out and go over it. So I could see, you know, if there were business meals or had I had business travel, you know, things for deductions. So yeah. You could sort of put the year together in your mind. But it was 24 pages, and I didn't want to wait around while it printed the whole 24 pages. So I pressed the print command, and I went out. I sometimes go to the Indian casinos in, near Santa Fe or in Santa Fe, and I like to play blackjack. Mm-hmm. So I'm not bad at that game, by the way. I more often come out a winner than a loser with very small stakes, $5 chips. Mm-hmm. So I came back to the house after I'd played at the casino, and I had dinner at the casino, and the dinner didn't agree with me. So I was feeling, you know, had a stomach upset. I got back to the house. And the first thing I did was, you know, well, I lock all the doors. We have a security system. I'm the only one there. And I go into my office and I collect the 24-page document, which is printed out. And, of course, the ink is dry. And I look it over and it looks – it's completely normal. There's nothing out of line about the document. I staple it and I take it upstairs. And I was really feeling nauseous. I put the document down on the bed, went into the bathroom. And was stomach sick, and then I came out about 5 minutes later. And as soon as I looked at the document, I could see that it had been changed. I was in shock when I saw this. I was just in shock because as I looked at it, what we call the ink obliteration, it was four words blacked out, neatly, precisely, clearly targeted. Mm-hmm. It couldn't have been some accident. You know, this wasn't water dripping from the ceiling or a leaky pen in the bed. Impossible. Because it was done so neatly, you could tell those words were chosen to be blacked out. Mm-hmm. And the ink or whatever was used to black it out was still moist. And the first two words, you could see through them. You could read the first two words, but the second two words were completely blacked out. And I didn't know whether I say second two words. I didn't know whether it was two words or three. You couldn't read it at all. I was going to have to go back to the original file to see what it was. So that was a key moment in my life because I felt fear. I was gripped with a very, very strange sensation. It's terrifying. Yeah. Why? Because I'm alone in the house. No one physically is present who could have done this, but someone had to do it. So what does that leave? That leaves a ghost, right? It was done by something unseen. There's nobody hiding in the house that did it. Mm-hmm. And I regarded it as evidence. And so I didn't touch it, didn't touch the ink. And I kept it very carefully. I photographed it. And within a number of weeks, I was taking that to a top chemistry laboratory at University of Indiana.
Right.
To begin the studies. And it took a while. It took quite a number of days for me to figure out what that ink obliteration, the words chosen, what it meant. Mm-hmm. Because at first, I'm just reacting with, you see something like that, and you know, you've seen in movies, maybe a pirate movie, the black spot, right?
Yeah.
What does the black spot mean? It means you're going to die, mm-hmm. right? And I had this fear, you know, this paranormal thing happened. Is, you know, is it telling me that I'm soon going to die? I mean, it's very, very, very scary when you can't explain something.
Yeah.
It, as it turns out, it had nothing to do with that. You know, I'm still alive after all these years and well. And the ink obliteration had very good intentions behind it. It wasn't intended to scare me. It was intended to send me a message, but I couldn't figure it out at first.
Mm-hmm.
So should I talk about how I figured it out? Is that
what? Yeah. Let's you know, satisfy that curiosity people are probably feeling and talk to us about what those words were and what the message was.
Okay. And I do hope, you know, I may be telling a lot of the story here, but I do hope people will get an atheist in heaven.
Oh, yeah. There's tons more stuff in there.
Read it all and see it all. Yeah, because this was the first incident. But we have a glossary in the book of 140 incidents, probably about 100 of which related to Fari Ackerman and happened in the years after he passed away. So this was just the opening chapter, step number one. Of a continuing friendship, a continuing relationship after he passed away. So the words themselves, all right, the words were spoke to Joe Amodei, and Joe Amodei was completely blacked out.
Mm-hmm.
Those were the words that you couldn't read. And when I saw on my computer file that it was spoke to Joe Amodei, it just didn't make any sense to me because this isn't somebody that I even really knew. He had been referred to me to talk to him about film distribution. You know, the question was, you know, was he interested in distributing my recent film, Jesus in India? And I had one conversation with him. He was a DVD distributor, but he wasn't interested in that, or at least it wasn't going to work for us. So why would anyone, living or dead, black out his name on my document?
Right.
And then I noticed a couple of lines higher on the document. It said, on a previous day, I had left message for Joe Amodei. Well, left message wasn't what was blacked out. Spoke to was what was blacked out. So why would the ghost, if you will, choose spoke to rather than left message? Why? What was he trying to say? What was the difference?
Right.
So I remembered that filmmakers who came to the tribute from Canada had told me about something paranormal that happened to them the day of the tribute that they thought was Fari contacting them. And so I'd heard that story from them. So it was in my mind, could this be a continuation of that? You know, was this from Fari? So I wanted to get some old manuscripts or see manuscripts that had his editing style. Because I wanted to know, how does he black out words when he's editing? Does he just put one simple little line through it? Or does he completely black out the words so you can't even read them?
Mm-hmm.
And I needed to find something that I knew was by him to answer that question. And I figured that the guy who would know the answer was Joe Mo, who'd lived with him for the last 10 years. And when I called Joe Mo to ask him, he didn't even let me get the question out. Here's the guy who had organized the tribute for Fari a week earlier, and he excitedly told me on the phone, he said, you know, I'm a skeptic like Fari was. I don't believe in this stuff, but it did happen to me. I don't know whether it was an apparition of Fari, a lucid dream. He said, this did happen just moments before I woke up. It was more real than anything in real life. Fari walked into my room with a smile on his face, and in his own way, a funny way, also, well, filled with movie references, thanked Joe for the tribute. Now, I had been a speaker at the tribute, too, so I had been part of it. And there were many other speakers, including Ray Bradbury and John Landis, and Peter Jackson checked in by video from New Zealand. So he said, Joe Mo said, you know, it was like Fari came and spoke to me.
There it is.
Yeah, there it is. Because what was blacked out was spoke to Joe Amodei or Amodei. And Joe Mo is right in the middle of Amodei, right?
Mm-hmm.
So clearly in Fari speak, with his wordplay that he always did, I find a long history of his puns, his wordplay, words within words, word games. There it is. Spoke to Joe Mo is the message. And in a way, I felt like he's reinforcing for me that he really did appear to Joe and speak to Joe. It wasn't some dream. It wasn't a hallucination. But it was real, and he was confirming it for me, you see.
Mm-hmm.
This is the only thing I could think of that made sense to explain what had happened to me. And once I had that thought in my mind, and I did make arrangements to go first to the top chemist at University of Indiana, I wanted to know, can science explain this?
Right.
Is there something I don't know that happened, you know, chemically? And because my attitude was, look, if the scientists can tell me why and how it happened and give me an ordinary explanation for it, then forget about your ghost, Paul, you know, no ghost. You know, you don't need to believe in that or anything paranormal, because here, we can map it right out for you. We can tell you just what happened.
Exactly.
You've given us the ink. We can study it with the best tools of modern science. And the result, Greg, was one scientist starts it. That's Dr. Jay Siegel, who was then chairman of the chemistry department, Indiana University, Purdue University, Indianapolis. I may have said University of Indiana before, but it's properly said it's, I think, Indiana University.
Mm-hmm.
And here's a man who's absolutely world-class experts on inks, paints, dyes, solvents, and forensic chemistry. Here's a man who's testified in many, many court cases where chemistry could be the thing that would determine guilt or innocence. And he's written textbooks on forensic chemistry. So it's no exaggeration to say Dr. Jay Siegel, one of the most important chemists in the United States. And he began the experimentation. He used like a pinhole prick thing to take little samples out of the ink. And the original analysis, I think, was spectrographic. And he was trying to see if he could identify, I think, a solvent. He had a long, long list of solvents and inks that he had studied, and he was trying to categorize it, and it wasn't matching up with anything he had. Well, there's a reason it wasn't matching up.
Right.
There were chemicals in the ink, that, as determined later by the scientist in New Jersey, that the chemicals of the original ink from the printer were there, but mixed in with other chemicals like silver and calcium chromate. So the spectrographic didn't give it a perfect match to anything.
And those were things that were used in inks like hundreds of years ago, right?
Yes. Yes. Mm. That's right. Particularly the calcium chromate was related to yellow and in paints, I think it was. And silver showed up in the ferrule of early paintbrushes.
Yeah. So I really love that chemical analysis. I mean, that just kind of sends a chill down your spine when you find out about that odd composition. But, you know, now that you've had 8 years worth of paranormal events following this game of interdimensional tag you've been playing with Forrest, how has this shaped your views on the afterlife and what it might be like? What have you learned about the, say, the rules of engagement or the limitations of it?
It's a really tough question and a good one. I think the first thing would be to say the basics. The basics of it is that there's evidence of the survival of Fari's intelligence and his personality and his sense of humor.
Mm-hmm.
So why personality? Well, you know, he was an editor. He word games, and that was the way he first communicated with me. And many of the contacts that followed had reflected, you know, the humor that was natural to his personality. So it's a way of his saying, I'm still here, of letting me know that he was wrong, and of continuing to interact and showing he continues to be aware, and particularly of things that relate to him. Now, the rules of engagement, that's a tough question, because most of the things that have happened when I didn't expect them at all. You know, it took me completely by surprise.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes they were things that almost seemed like jokes or pranks. You'd think, you know, what's the meaning behind that? You know, he's just trying to give me a little nudge on the shoulder and tell me he's still here.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of them were things that related directly to him. You know, like when a mask of his face moves by itself across the room, 10 feet, with no explanation for how it has moved. Or when, this was a good one, and the fact that he makes a silence gesture that we use on the cover. So silence, you know, the silence of the night, you know, this is one of the things of his sort of his zombie horror culture, right?
Yeah, of course.
His love of Bela Lugosi and Dracula. And the fact that when I tried to do the final output of the film that was going to go to broadcast for the Sci-Fi Channel, the sound completely cut out of the movie exactly when a friend of Fari's who was present when Fari died was talking about Fari's silence gesture. So he's talking about the silence gesture that indicates the silence of death. And at that moment, there's no more soundtrack in the movie until the very end of the movie. You know, it makes no sense unless it's intentional. The odds of it happening are absolutely minuscule, and there was nothing wrong with the hard drives or the data that went into creating this.
Right.
So when the listeners read An Atheist in Heaven, you'll see the vast array of things that happen. And then the things that happen to the scientists. For example, I talked about Jay Siegel. I didn't talk about Dr. Allison, John Allison, who's contributed two chapters to An Atheist in Heaven. When he began to study this at Jay Siegel's request, using laser desorption to dissect the chemistry, from the very first day of the studies, when I brought the document to him, unexplained phenomena began to happen to him. And some of it was caught on film. I say film, I mean videotape, on camera. A number of these things that have happened through the years have been caught on camera while the camera was rolling, which I think it's wonderful we got that kind of evidence. So the rules of the engagement seem to include allowing us here in corporeal form on the Earth to have tangible evidence, to know that we're interacting with intelligence from another realm that we can't see.
And a lot of it does seem subtle. I mean, not only in this case, but other cases, or it seems maybe personal, these little brief slivers of strangeness. But I do love synchronicities. And one thing that I've learned about synchronicity is that it usually works in these weird groupings of connections where oftentimes you can close a loop around three or four different points of coincidence. And you mentioned the Blue Fauri painting, or the gesture, the hush gesture. And that touches on another thing that's really compelling, and it has to do with that Blue Fauri painting. It's another great example of one of these loops. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes. Well, the original painting by L.J. Dopp, which became the cover of the Life After Death Project. It has a clock in the background with the hands of the clock at 2 minutes to midnight. And it was painted 4 years before Fari passed away. Well, Earl Rozelle, who was present when Fari died, reports that Fari died at 2 minutes to midnight. And that's exactly what the hands of the clock showed in the painting that was made 4 years before he died. So that's a really inexplicable. Okay, so as a major skeptic would say, well, coincidence. How are you going to explain it? Time travel, you know, that a Fari spirit from the future goes back in time and influences the artist and knows when he's going to, you know, you can't explain it in logical terms at all. But the mystery was compounded, the mystery of the painting, when I was asked to write an article about this for Fate magazine.
Yes.
It was called The Strange Case of Forrest J. Ackerman. And while I was writing a paragraph I wrote on the first page of the article about L.J. Dopp's painting, right in the middle of L.J. Dopp's name, after, I think it was after the L.J., there's a huge misprint in the article that suddenly says the blackout in two levels of opacity of four words in my document, or in the document. I don't know the words exactly, but it said, and then it said, spoke to Joe Amade.
Yeah.
And it repeated itself, the blackout, two levels of opacity, spoke to Joe Amade. And then it went on with what I had written for the magazine.
Yeah, weird, mid-sentence.
Mid-sentence, right? While talking about the artist who painted the painting that related to his death. And the article had been proofread by four people, including the publisher and managing editor, before it went to press. And they said it had no problems with it. So it's like, again, the logical mind can't explain it.
Mm-hmm. And these things reference each other.
Yeah, self-referential. And sometimes these things have happened either while I've been on, doing a radio or a podcast. Things have happened very definitely. Like just the other day, I was doing an interview and they had a break for a commercial after 20 minutes.
That's a misplay.
Now, they hadn't purposely selected commercials. As a matter of fact, the producer told me afterwards, he said, no, I had no idea what commercial was going to come up. He said, I looked and saw the first one was supposed to come up and I knew it was one we all found obnoxious we didn't like. And so I killed it from the list. And so it just went to the next one. And the ad, it begins with a song saying, come to the forest, come to the forest. It's closer than you know. In the forest, you will find the real you, the new you that you didn't know. Brought to you by the National Forest Service. And FARI is short for forest. You know, right. He's Forest J. Ackerman. So that's quite a synchronicity for you when no one intended it. And one of the ones I really like, Greg, I heard about from a writer named Robert Egbie, who saw an early version of the Life After Death Project before it was finished.
Mm-hmm.
And then he saw the final one with his girlfriend. They both watch it together and fascinated. And when it's done, she takes out her cell phone and intends to check her emails, but accidentally presses the navigation instead of email. And what comes up is a map, not of where they are then, but of a location 10 miles away with Ackerman Road filling the screen in the middle. His name again.
Jeez.
It keeps happening.
Mm-hmm.
So when you say rules of engagement, maybe there are no rules of engagement, or it's mainly initiated from his side.
Right.
He keeps poking at us to sort of wake us up at moments that we maybe least expected.
And to add another log to the fire in terms of one of my favorite additions of synchronicity in this whole thing, there is another reference to the inkblot obliteration event when you find a magazine that Forey had signed for you and his inscription is right above the phrase, "The invisible ink men strike again." And, you know, that one, people might say, oh, that's a little loose. But when you stack these things up, I mean, this is how synchronicity works.
I know. It works more like a dream than physical reality. Yes, he had autographed that. And even the autograph above those words, "The invisible ink men strike again." The autograph acknowledged Ray Harryhausen, the great special effects director. And
yeah.
He was signing us because there was a big article about Harryhausen in there. And he wrote, "Hooray for Harryhausen and Paul Davids." But he didn't write just the word "hooray." He wrote H-O-O and then a hyphen and then R-A-Y. So it shows his propensity to find a name within a word, like he did with Joe Amodi. Or Amode, where Mo is right there in the middle of it. So he signed that autograph, and as you say, this was on the table of contents page for Famous Monsters magazine, and it said Fang Mail, and it said "The Invisible Ink Men Strike Again." Now, when you think about that, the incident that happened to me, it wasn't invisible ink. It wasn't ink turning invisible, although Jack Kelleher, who wrote a chapter for An Atheist in Heaven, he had an incident of FARI-related ink turning invisible. But if you take it as the invisible ink man,
right?
He's invisible. He's the ink man. He's come to put the ink on the document.
Yeah, he struck some words out.
And he struck some words out. He's striking again. How many times is he going to strike? And I'll tell you, I've got a copy of An Atheist in Heaven here on my desk in case I needed to refer to a chapter or remember something while talking to you. And this particular copy on the side of, the pages,
mm-hmm.
when the book is closed, it has a black ink line right in the middle of all those pages, about 3/4 inch long. And I don't know how it got there. I don't,
Or maybe you do.
Well, maybe I do. But I could say, all right, did I have a felt tip marker pen sitting on my desk? Did I just sort of push the book against it? And is that how it happened? I have no recollection of that. But on the other hand, this doesn't look like what would happen if you accidentally pushed something against a pen, because it's not scribbled in any way. Mm-hmm. It's just a straight line again. And hold on a second here. I'm noticing something I didn't notice before. Remember how I said that the original ink obliteration was in two levels of opacity, right?
Yes.
Well, this line is too. The first half of it, the ink is kind of light, and then it gets very, very dark. This is on the side of the pages of a copy of the book. I don't know. You know, that's something. I've got enough better examples, you know, that we don't need to dwell on this.
Right.
But it's just that when it happens to you, you become more aware to look for all of these kinds of things. And I think – I know we don't have much time left, Greg.
Right.
And I would like to, you know, here toward the ending, help the listeners that they'd like to find these things that I've done, again, to remind them that An Atheist in Heaven – which was published in April of 2016. If you look for that title at Amazon.com, you'll find it available. You can get it as a hardback with dust jacket, and they have it at a discount there, I think, for right now they're selling it for around $21, I think. List price is $30. Mm-hmm. And they have it as an ebook for, I think, $9, which you can use for your iPad or, you know, Kindle. And then for the documentary film, The Life After Death Project, you can rent it online. I think you can probably download it online. You can stream it at Amazon Prime. Or I recommend getting the two DVD set because you've got two DVDs. You've got the first movie that was on Sci-Fi Channel. Then you have the sequel of equal length that I made. And 40 minutes of bonus features on top of that. That includes much of the tribute to Forrest J. Ackerman. And a wonderfully comprehensive statement by the chemist who spent the most time studying our ink obliteration. Hmm. So those are the opportunities. And then my other films. Oh, if you go to Internet Movie Database, that's imdb.com, and look for me, I'm Paul Davids. That's David with an S. They might show a couple people with similar names, and I'm the one that did the Transformers show. So you click on that. You'll see a listing of all my different films and TV shows, and most of them are still available. And, you know, you'll want to see Roswell, which was the movie for Showtime about the 1947 UFO crash, Starry Night, Before We Say Goodbye. Wonderful story, in my opinion, based on a stage play that gets into the mystery of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And, you know, there's The Artist and the Shaman. Oh, certainly The Sci-Fi Boys. And Jesus in India. All of these different projects I have spent the last 15 to 20 years putting together to help open minds and take topics that some may consider slightly fringe topics. Oh, including Timothy Leary's Dead Too, which that soon will be up for streaming. They're working on that now.
Nice.
But all of these topics to help broaden minds, answer questions, and take you places that you on your own initiative might otherwise not go.
Nice. Yeah, I love that approach. You've definitely covered some kind of out there subject matter, done it in an entertaining way, made a good life for yourself doing it. It seems like a win-win-win for everybody. I mean, I think that's a great approach to life, and you're playing the game of capitalism that we really can't help but play. But great stuff, man. I really did enjoy the book. Very convincing body of evidence. You also are going to be at an upcoming conference, if I'm not mistaken, right?
You mean the one in November?
It says Art, Music, and UFOs, The Evolution of Human Consciousness.
Yes, that's in Laughlin, Nevada. And I've been there the last 2 years. It's a conference organized by my good friend Paola Harris. She's Italian. She's a ufologist and a writer. And knows a lot of really interesting people she brings to those conferences. I think that that's a great opportunity to go there. I was just a speaker this year at the International UFO Congress put on by Open Minds, and I did speak about the Marilyn Monroe film. And that, of course, is the other one. I don't know how many more I'm going to be making. That's they take a couple years each, and they take a lot out of me, you know. But
I'm sure
Marilyn Monroe Declassified will be released this year on, you know, DVD, Blu-ray. It'll show up for streaming, I'm sure.
Nice.
But do avoid the piracy sites, because they're really putting us in a position that makes it very difficult for people who do what I do to continue.
It's true.
It's a complete disrespect of copyright, and we work hard to do these things. So we appreciate it when you access them through the proper channels.
Right. You really have to support the artists that you want to be able to continue to make work. Otherwise, they can't do it. Same thing we face here. But it is a weird world, no doubt. I really enjoyed talking to you. Thanks so much for being here. Take care of yourself out there, and tell Fori we said what's up.
Thank you.
There we go, people. Paul Davids, closing out the month of May for THC. And this isn't typically the type of show I like to do, but I did think it was a good case study of life after death contact. It's a weird thing. It always seems to be so indirect and subtle, or maybe subtle isn't the best word for it, when masks are flying off your walls, but instead of crossing out a couple lines of paper, why not say, hey, what do you know? There is an afterlife, and it ain't so bad, you know? But it is still pretty wild. And I do like looking at those things, especially in the context of last week's show with Gordon, where we're talking about contacting spirits and ancestors. I thought it might be a good follow-up. And who doesn't want to talk to someone largely responsible for the Transformers cartoon, huh? But I do wonder how this life-after-death cycle works. I think we all do. And when you have a breakthrough experience where you realize there is another plane of existence, that's great to have, but it's kind of like the ending of Lost. Way more questions come up than answers. What is it like to just be a spirit existing in a dimension of timelessness devoid of matter? How long do you stay there before getting another body? Do you have to get another body? Does everyone get another body? I mean, kids come through with verifiable evidence and memories of their past lives, so something is up there. Why don't more dead relatives make contact? Do they just stand around and wait to greet us on the other side? What do they do with their time? Just watch and wait? I don't know. It's an odd situation, this life and death thing we do. I wish we could get more definitive answers, but for now, I guess all we got are these little slivers of clues. The synchronicities in stories like these are always a bit interesting to me. So, big thanks again to him and all the great guests this month. I really enjoyed the Agenda 31 show with Corey and Todd and Success Magic with Gordon. Those were my other personal favorites. I thought those shows had the most useful info. And I guess I'll have a bit more to say in the THC newsletter coming out the first of the month. Sign up for free at thehiresidechats.com on the sidebar or right from the Facebook page for THC. And I'll let you know who is on deck for next month. But thanks for listening. Sign up for Plus if you want to hear more. And by all means, forge your path to happiness as best you can in this backwards world we're in. That's it for me this week. Your move, ancestors of the afterlife and spirits of the great beyond. Your fucking move.
Oh no, you see, the world is in random. It's attached to puppet strings, control over everything. The 9 to 5 is trying to steal ya. Now don't that job seem silly? Hello, can you hear me? Or should I play back recordings from some spy agency? Wish we were younger and free. I'll be thankful when it's all exposed, the vast conspiracy. There's such a difference between us and the damn world.
Hey.
Guys, thanks for listening to the first hour of the Higher Side Chats podcast with me, Greg Carlwood. If you don't know, there is a second hour to all the episodes we do around here. Generally, we're able to get a lot deeper into the topics and ideas that a guest is about, so if you enjoyed what you've heard from THC for free, consider signing up at thehiresidechatsplus.com to get the second hour of the five shows I put together each month. I never really wanted to be a paid subscriber podcast, but I really hate the idea of spending airtime promoting some product that's completely unrelated and telling you the best way to support the show is to buy an audiobook or new underwear by mail or something crazy like that. So instead, if you like the show, double your time with it for $5 a month and let's cut out all the other shit. It's half the price of a movie ticket and you get at least an extra 5 hours of show a month. Collectively, it keeps us stable and it frees me from wasting your time with anything but the show you came to listen to. It's really the only way for an independent, one-man show to make it, and I do what I can so that it's worth your while. Since we started this, I've always tried to use the subscriptions to improve the podcast and make signups more advantageous. It started with just a second hour for the main show, but now we've got a nice forum going where people can get deeper in conversation about the episodes with other listeners, submit a candidate in the guest request thread, or share their own personal projects to get out of the soul-crushing 9-to-5 cog-in-the-wheel life on the entrepreneurs thread. The forum and the plus comments are always the first places I try to go for listener engagement, but it does get harder as the show gets more popular. Because of that, there's also a direct messaging feature that you can use to reach me through the plus site also. But beyond the forum, if you like any of the music I've used for THC, most of it I've hired artists to make, and I provide it all as free downloads to Plus members too. So if you like a particular song you've heard close the show out recently, come get the MP3. I should also mention that if you don't like the idea of paying $5 recurring every month, I get that. You can buy 3 months, 6 months, or a year up front and just be done with it. I have plenty of listeners who send checks and money orders to the P.O. Box too. I try to make it as easy for people as I can, and you can read more about it on the sign-up page. Also, be sure to check out the FAQ help page on the Plus site. If you have any questions or concerns about how to listen to a password-protected show on your devices, I've highlighted a lot of great solutions, and one of those would be the iPhone app that just recently hit the Apple App Store. A super kind and talented listener made it for us, and you can use it to stream or download either the free or the Plus show. If you're on Android, I'd use Pocket Casts or Podcast Addict and subscribe to the feed manually that way. I also try to throw in occasional bonus shows or Q&A shows, and I've got a few other weird ideas I might get to try out soon, but I give you all I can for $5, and I hope you'll at least give it a shot if you've listened to a few free shows and you find them unique or valuable. I know there's a lot of podcasts out there, and I'm just one of them. But if you have any questions, concerns, or comments about any of this, please get in touch with us at thehiresidechatsteam@gmail.com. I also wanted to plug the Higher Side newsletter I'm going to be putting out, totally free for anyone who wants to sign up at the main internet website for the show, thehiresidechats.com. You can also get on that email list through the Higher Side Chats Facebook page. There's a button there as well. But the reason I'm doing this is because I get tons and tons of emails after a show goes up asking me about how I feel about a particular guest or topic, and the wrap-up isn't always the best place to do that, especially if I have anything negative to say. Sometimes the dust needs to settle, sometimes I need to hear feedback from you guys first. There are a lot of factors, but I usually have something to communicate to you, and I just don't get to do it. So on the first of the month, I plan to send out a little newsletter with my thoughts about the 5 shows the previous month and talk to you about anything else that's on my mind or that's going on. And what's probably most enticing is that I'm going to give you some insight into at least one guest I have coming up in the month, which people have been begging for some posted schedule for a long time. I personally think I'd like the surprise. But sign up for the Higher Side newsletter. It's free. It comes out on the first of the month, and I won't waste your time with any other emails. And that's it. I appreciate you listening. I try to give alternative ideas and guests a fair shake on a high-quality podcast, expose some deep-level conspiracies without the yelling, and I hope to offer some inspiration that even though the system relentlessly suggests you should follow their blueprint to mediocrity, you can do your own thing and live a much happier life despite all the negativity in the world. So go ahead and treat yourself. Isn't it about time?